This is episode 49. Let's do this.
This is the business of architecture. Helping architects conquer the world. And here's your host, Enoch Sears.
Welcome back, Architect Nation. This is Enoch Bartlett Sears, and this is the show where we talk about what they did not teach us in school, how to run a great business in the field of architecture. Today's guest is Steve L. Wintner, AIA Emeritus. He's the founder and principal of Management Consulting Services, a professional consulting firm located in the Austin, Texas area, and focused on enhancing the productivity and profitability of professional design firms. He's the co-author of the book Financial Management for Design Professionals, The Path to Profitability. And this is a re-record of the previous session we had. It wasn't up to the standards that Steve and I wanted. And so just to let the audience know that we've edited this and we're going to provide some additional value in this particular conversation. So for those of you who are listening, you're going to remember that at my very first episode, I had Osha Wilson on, who had a great interview about starting an architecture firm, and she mentioned Mr. Wintner's book during that interview. Shortly after that, there was a run, shall we say, on the books. Quite a few books were purchased, and currently it's very difficult to buy the book as it's out of print. You may be able to find it on the web. I think I saw some copies on Amazon or some on eBay, but the asking price is well above its original price point. And I think that this speaks to the value that architects are finding in the thing that the book contains. So I'm excited to have Steve on the show today. And Steve, welcome to the show.
Enoch, thanks very much. I do appreciate the opportunity to have a chance to visit with you about this. If I may, though, I'd like to make a brief comment about the price of the book as a correction that's more current.
Yeah.
Because Amazon sold out, the resellers are now trying to sell it, and you can get it for about $90, which again is an absurd price. But I noticed that you could actually go to Barnes & Noble and ask them to order it for you for the original price of $49.95. You could probably also go to Kaplan AEC Education Publishers, who were the original publishers, and ask them if they'll sell it to you at their original price point. As of last year, we were able to assist others to buy it at that price point from them.
Excellent. Well, thank you for sharing that, Steve. I'm sure you'll make some listeners out there happy to know that it's still available at the lower price point. But having said that, you're working on a new and updated version of this book.
Yes.
Well, tell me about that. Tell me what inspired the new book, how the process is going, and what is it going to contain?
Well, it's born out of the fact that Kaplan decided not to do a second printing of the book. They were all out of copies except for a very small number, and they were not able to fill any real kind of orders. So they decided that because the volume of sales wasn't up to their standards, they weren't going to do a second printing. So we contacted Kaplan, Michael Tardif, and I, my co-author, and asked them if they would be willing to allow us to do a second printing. We got into a long, drawn-out conversation, and the short outcome of that was that they eventually gave us the full right, title, and ownership of the copyright for the manuscript, and that allowed us to do whatever we wish with it. So Michael and I are now in the process of rewriting it for our second publication, which will be an electronic version, not a paper version of the book. It'll probably be in a Kindle format or an ebook format, and hopefully that'll happen sometime before the end of the year.
Well, that's very technologically up-to-date. Excellent. And what valuable informations are architects going to find in the new manuscript?
Well, it's not going to be a whole lot of different things than the original printing. It's just that we're cleaning it up. There are a lot of things that we now, in retrospect, after reading it and understanding what we wrote, that we could have been a bit more clear in the things we described and how we described them. It'll be a little bit more expansive about the things that we didn't talk enough about. So that's basically what we're doing. We're cleaning it up. We're expanding it where it needs to be expanded. We're contracting where it doesn't need to be as long. And we're still maintaining the same basic format. So the book isn't really going to change per se. It's just going to be a better version.
Excellent. I know that in the book you talked about the 7 key performance indicators that design professionals should be looking at. And you talk about reporting, ways to structure that. We're going to touch on that now and also later in the interview.
Okay.
All right. So just to give our listeners an overview, in this interview today, we're going to be talking about some of the common management deficiencies that Steve sees when he works with professional design firms. And he's also going to talk about why a systematic approach is important in your business, how that can help you boost productivity and then also boost profit. And we're also going to talk a little bit about, in the next episode, which is going to be next week, we're going to dive into the financial management side of things. So I'm looking forward to the conversation, Steve. And once again, thanks for being on the show.
Thank you for inviting me.
You bet. So, Steve, what are some common management deficiencies that you see when working with professional design firms?
Well, I don't know if the word deficiency is the right word for describing these things. Every firm is unique, in my opinion, and they bring with it their talent, their skill, their abilities, their knowledge, and their experience. It's all different because of the mix of the individuals that are part of each firm. In general, just a very general statement, I'm not trying to make a global statement specifically about the whole profession, but in general, because of the work that I do, I found that there's really a lack of true understanding and knowledge about financial management systems. This is born out of what most firms usually use, some kind of accounting software. In other words, a software that every firm isn't able to purchase because it's a very expensive product. There are only three of them on the market right now, Deltek, Axiom, and the third one is Clearview and Focus. Most principals really don't know what to do with all this material. It's all too much information for them. It overwhelms them, so they tend to rely upon their accounting people, either their in-staff who are doing their accounting or bookkeeping, or an outside CPA or an accountant to help them to get through this. But they truly don't understand these systems. So that's one area that's a great concern for me. As principals of a firm, the CEO, the people who are running the firm, they really need to know and understand their financial status, what their condition is, rather than just referring to a report. The second thing is a lack of awareness about the importance of creating some kind of employee retention policy. By that I mean there's a saying in our profession that our people are our greatest assets, or our staff is our greatest asset. I think that's just lip service because I don't think too many firms really demonstrate that very well. They don't really do look after their staff. I happen to be fortunate enough to have had the experience of working with a firm that did that to the nth degree. They were very focused on the importance of developing and improving their relationship with their staff, as well as giving them the kind of guidance and training they needed so they could become a greater contribution to the firm and then begin to share in the wealth of the firm that they had helped to create. The third thing has a lot to do with communication. Now, I would call this a deficiency because most of us do not know how to properly and effectively communicate in the work environment. Nor do we take the time to learn how to do that in the best possible way. But I think that learning how to delegate, manage one's time, the areas of time management delegate, are two interconnected areas that suffer from a clear understanding about an appropriate and beneficial way of doing those things. Stephen Covey was probably for me the greatest impetus that I could have had about learning about how to delegate properly. He kept it really simple. There are only two forms of delegation as far as he was concerned, stewardship delegation and gopher delegation. In the area of time management, I contribute this quote to an unknown author who simply said, "Only do what only you can do and delegate the rest," as a mantra for how to operate if you're going to be in a CEO position. You can't do everything, so you have to learn how to delegate.
Yeah.
You should learn to do what only you can do and let everybody else do the rest. With that comes a whole deal of understanding about how to delegate properly and how to communicate effectively so the outcomes are what you expect and what you would want them to be.
Excellent. So I'm going to go back to the first point here, Steve, which is that you said that you find that a lot of firms don't understand some of the finer points of accounting. Now, I'm just paraphrasing here, so if I misstate you, please correct me. But I'd like to ask you, what is it specifically, maybe give me one or two examples, of what you see that they're not understanding?
Well, it's not the finer points. I mean, after all, nothing in our education process helped us to understand accounting procedures.
Right, right.
We really know nothing about accounting. Everything that I know about accounting is self-taught because I've been interested and I needed to learn more about it. But I still don't know what I really would need to know if I was going to be an accountant. I know enough to be dangerous, however, and I don't deal with accounting. I deal with financial management, which is an aspect of accounting, but it's more internalized to the firm. And it doesn't have any impact on the firm's tax liability, and it doesn't have anything to do with whether it meets government standards or things of that nature. It only helps to better understand how the firm is functioning and performing and how well they may be doing financially on a month-to-month basis. So it really comes down to a lack of knowing what accounting offers. We've been so tuned in to know that you have a limited number of options about how to get information out of your system, out of your accounting procedures. Basically, that comes down to those three accounting systems that I talked about are something like QuickBooks, which, in my opinion, is probably the worst of all possible software systems that a service firm could use.
Why do you say that?
Well, because it really has nothing to do with the operations of a professional service firm. Even though they have improved on it greatly, they've created a professional services edition, which I think is an enormous help and a stride in the right direction, but it still contains a lot of things that are not just helpful, and it lacks other things that should be included that they don't provide. Those are the things that come out of the work that I've been doing for the last 29 years that are all related to, and I refer lovingly to, as the Maddox format.
Okay, so please give me one or two examples. I'm sure this isn't Maddox format, but give me one or two examples of things that QuickBooks does not provide that are important for a professional services firm.
Well, there's no delineation of the difference between direct labor and indirect labor. It's just labor, and they call it cost of goods sold. Well, that doesn't mean anything. There's no such thing as cost of goods sold. We don't sell anything. We sell time. We don't have a product. All we do is sell our time. So in that, they don't delineate between what we consider to be direct labor, which is focused on projects, or indirect labor, focused on the things that are beyond the project, that are not project-related, that are not chargeable to a project. That's a very major area that's not provided. They also don't properly format the profit-loss statement to reflect the relationship between the firm's revenue and the revenue that's created by outside consultants who contribute to the project, and those are expenses, and how those expenses should be subtracted from the firm's revenue.
Well, you talked about direct labor and indirect labor, and you gave us a contextual definition of that. I'm just going to repeat and see if I understand it correctly, and you can correct me where I go astray. It sounded like direct labor is labor that is directly related or billed to one particular project.
I'll correct a word if I may.
Sure, okay.
Forget the word billable. There's really any such thing as billable time. The only true billable time is on a project that has an hourly fee contract without any fee limitation. You just bill for whatever you spend your time on. Those jobs are very few and far between, if they even exist anymore. They're usually the kinds of projects that small firms or individuals have that operate on a very small basis. They're very, very hard to come by, as are any clients who would agree to do it that way. We have a much more sophisticated client base right now, so you very rarely see an hourly fee without any kind of upside limit on how much you can invoice the client. So instead of billable, the correct terminology would be chargeable. In other words, whatever you do on a project is chargeable to the project. Whether it gets billed or not is a different story. If most projects are actually invoiced to the client on a percent of completion, which is the way most of them are because they're based on a fixed fee, then really none of the hours are truly billable. So you're not billing hours. You're billing a percentage of the fee, which is relative to the amount of work that's been completed. But it's also not directly related to the hours spent because the hours spent may exceed the fee budget. Now, those hours spent may not be controlled. They may not be monitored. And the team may have already blown the budget in terms of the direct labor. So it's simply a reference to time charged to a project.
Okay. So direct labor is chargeable.
Right.
Right. And indirect labor is labor that...
Everything else.
Okay, Okay.
Any other time that's spent that's not project related, in other words.
Got it. So when you mentioned that QuickBooks has no ability to differentiate between direct labor and indirect labor, what does that mean for an architecture firm? If they can't delineate between those two, how does that affect their business?
Well, it doesn't mean they don't have the ability to. I'm just simply saying that they don't do that. they could do that just as easily as the other three accounting system softwares do, but QuickBooks, they just don't do. They don't happen to include the function that like that right now, as far as I'm aware of. To my knowledge, they have yet to come to that level of sophistication with their professional services edition of QuickBooks.
Okay, and what does that mean for architecture firms if they can't tell how much time was spent through their accounting software on direct labor versus indirect labor?
Well, they'll never be able to ascertain the true level of their profitability. They'll never be able to ascertain a true overhead rate or a break-even rate, which means they'll never be able to calculate a reasonable or accurate or beneficial billing rate.
Sounds important to me. This is the business of architecture show, after all.
Yes.
Well, that's a great example. And the second thing you mentioned was that firms that do not have an employee retention policy, you said that some firms don't take care of their staff. What did you mean by that when you said that you see some firms that don't take care of their staff?
Well, I'm simply saying that there isn't a focus on their internal resource, their great resource of labor that they have, to nurture them, develop them, train them, and try to encourage loyalty and an ability to contribute to the firm's growth and development and profitability through that kind of development. They just seem to take them for granted. It's like they are drones. They feed them the information. They'll give them only what they need to know and not anything more than they need to know, and yet expect to get the best out of them. Well, that's an unreasonable expectation. They're all valuable to the firm, every single one of them, right down to the individual who sits at a desk and does nothing but administrative duties, even if they don't have any project-related duties. They're all an essential part of the firm. Respecting them and what their needs are to be successful in their job and helping them to be successful at their job is the best kind of policy to have, because it will help to retain the best of them.
Yes, I've talked to...
I just want to say that I believe that employees never leave a firm because they're happy. They leave because they feel they're not going to get what they need and they want to advance their careers. A firm needs to develop and grow these young architects who are coming into the industry and are looking for greater knowledge and improving themselves. So it's not surprising that if they're going to look for something else, if their firm isn't meeting their needs. Now, the staff may also feel that they're not getting paid enough, which is another factor that's rampant in our industry. I happen to believe that there's not enough of a distribution of the wealth, as I call it, between upper management and staff.
So how could that be fixed? Let's jump on that topic for a minute, some suggestions for alternate ways of doing it. Let's talk about some staff who feel like they're not getting the pay that they would like.
Okay. Well, you come back to an essential ingredient. Do you really understand what you have in the way of financial resources to be able to provide the best possible compensation for your staff in order to retain their services and to make sure that you get the best out of them so they help to contribute to that resource each and every year? If you don't have the right tools, which is your financial management system, then you're not going to be able to come up with a good, sound business decision that's based on reality. You're not going to have some indication of what it is, and it could lead to problems down road. Most firms are small firms, which means that they're less than 10 people. The preponderance of the 80,000 architects in the AIA work in firms with a staff of less than 10 people. If that's the case, then you understand that there's not going to be a whole lot of dollars flowing into these small firms. Every dollar that comes in has got to be managed, properly accounted for, and used as effectively as possible to generate the best possible return.
Mm-hmm. So in your experience, when you say that you see firms that aren't taking care of their staff, do you see it as a conscious choice or more of an ignorance?
No, I think it's not conscious at all. I don't think it's a deliberate thing. I don't think it's malicious. I don't think it's anything more than a lack of focus, a lack of recognizing that there are things that could be done. It isn't brain surgery. It isn't going to take a whole lot of money and effort to correct this situation. It just takes caring about making a change in your mentality and mindset about understanding the value of your people and then helping them to get you to get what you want. That's what they're there for that very purpose, to produce the product that you want to produce for your clients so your clients are happy and they keep coming back. But if you don't treat them well, they're not going to stick around. It's just the way a lot of firms lose some really good people.
Can you give me an example that a firm could do to differentiate themselves and flip that on its head to retain their employees and their good talent?
All right. Well, that could go back to the one thing a lot of firms do. Some do it well, some don't do it enough, and some don't do it at all, and that's a performance review for each employee. The question then begs, how often do you do an employee review? Is it an annual review? Is it a semi-annual review? Is it up to management, the firm, to make a decision that works best for them? It's time-consuming. There's no question that it takes time to do a good performance review. That will play into the frequency of doing them. It could mean that it will be limited to once a year or twice a year at the very most, but it's the content of the review, the focus of the review, that could lead to this kind of change. It's not a review to discuss mistakes made over the last 12 months. It's better as a tool to set goals for accomplishments in the next 12 months so that at the end of that year they can go back and review those goals and see if they were actually achieved. But if you don't set goals in the first place for these people, if you don't help them to understand what you're expecting of them, if you don't give them a path to follow that have clear guidelines and understand what is expected of them, how can they possibly succeed? So it's not hard to believe that these kinds of reviews turn out to be more a matter of disgruntlement after it's over, mostly on the part of the employee, because all they got was a lot of criticism. They were told what was wrong with them instead of focusing on what they did well, and there wasn't any direction provided for helping them to improve. Now, again, I'm not condemning my profession. I'm not condemning every firm. I'm just simply saying that there's something that's rampant in far too many firms. There are a lot of firms that do reviews really, really well, but it takes an understanding of what needs to be included and what's its purpose. Why do you do it? What are you trying to accomplish? What's your objective? What's your intention? That has to start, in my opinion, with caring about the individual in your firm and helping them to do the very best they possibly can so they can help you.
Excellent. So we're talking about employee retention here, and you talked about changing the way we do employee reviews, giving them a clear path and goals to strive forward, and then measuring that. Now, I know, Steve, that you're working on a new book that's going to be talking about the culture of accountability in professional design firms.
Yes.
Okay, what are some other ways that professional design firms need to have more accountability?
Well, I even question the word more accountability. I'm sorry, but with all due respect to all of my professional colleagues, and understand that I don't have full knowledge of every single firm in the United States.
Of course.
But it's been my experience, being exposed to a great deal of my colleagues' operations over the last 29 years, that there's precious little in the area of accountability established in a firm as a culture, as a value. I don't think it's done because of any kind of malicious intent. I don't think that it's just a lack. I do think it's just a lack of focus. It's a lack of recognizing what the purpose is of such a thing and why you would do such a thing. What's the benefit that comes from it? It's just another part of this employee retention program. It's about creating an environment in which everybody is going in the same direction for the same reason with the same goals in mind and then being rewarded as they do perform and they do create and contribute to the kind of environment that is desired by the firm's principals. So that requires everybody from the principal down, the CEO, the partner, the owner, the single one owner of a firm, all of them being willing to be held accountable. For me personally, in my opinion, therein lies the problem. Very few principals that I've been in touch with are willing to be held accountable for their behavior. In fact, they think that they're above being held accountable because who is going to question them? Who's going to look at them and objectively give them objective feedback about my accountability? Who's going to hold them accountable? Well, that's a narrow-minded thought process, in my opinion. That's not seeing a bigger picture. That's not recognizing the possibilities and the potential for what's available to you if you become more knowledgeable about the process and learn more about it. This is one of the reasons that has stimulated me into believing that I need to write about this subject and that I need to put out more information about the subject, because I'm not aware of very much of anything that's available in the marketplace about this subject that pertains to our industry.
Absolutely. Well, I really look forward to reading it when it comes out, Steve. And that's an interesting concept, accountability for firm principals and firm owners. And I know that there are other industries that have some practices that address that. Tell me what that looks like for an architecture firm, and in what way would they be held accountable? What status would they be measured on? Just help me understand how this concept could be applied.
Well, I'll give you an example that goes back to the performance review. By the way, it's not accountability just for firm owners and firm principals. It's accountability as a culture of the firm.
Mm. Got it.
It's not less important than any one thing the firm does or has a value or a system as a way of operating. It's just an integrated part of it all. It's how they operate. It's how they function. It's how they work together. What is the environment? That kind of environment will promote a greater sense of ownership by every employee and a greater sense of being a part of the whole, a greater sense of contributing to the whole, and then being properly and appropriately rewarded for their efforts. So I think the purpose here is to bring this concept forward. Let's go back to the employee performance review. That, in and of itself, could be a way to begin this process because it becomes a place in which a dialogue that's open, candid, and sharing could go both ways. In other words, the process would include subordinates contributing to the review of their supervisors, a review process that allows both upward and downward feedback. What I'm basically saying is that it shouldn't be a top-down management policy, which is the way most firms function. I'm not talking about a democratic, across-the-board, everybody equal kind of thing. No, I'm not suggesting that. Everybody has their place in the firm. Everybody has their responsibilities in the firm. But those things have to be clearly delineated.
Hmm. Steve, can you give me a practical example or tactical example of what that would look like? Maybe a change that people listening today could go back and implement in their firms to foster this kind of accountability culture?
Sure. Let's start with one little basic thing that has to do with communication of expectations to your employees. Let's say that I'm a 10-person firm. I'm a single owner, no one else but me. I'm the boss, I'm the top guy, there's no one else but me and the rest of my employees, great employees. Now, I don't know how widespread this is. I don't have any statistical data that tells me what this is, and I'm not making any claims one way or the other, but it would be so helpful to my 9 employees if I can define for them their roles and responsibilities within the functions that they are best suited for. In other words, creating a position description for how they are expected to work, what their roles and responsibilities are within that role. That's clarifying for them a pathway, a way of getting to the kinds of results that one is shooting for that allows them to look at it, read it, understand it, and if they have questions about it, they do question things that they don't think are appropriate to be able to discuss that as part of their concerns. It's an open dialogue. When you present it, it's not just implemented as this is the policy, these are the rules, this is who you are, and this is the niche that you fall into. That, by the way, is not a niche. You're just not assigned to this label that you're a project architect, or you're a CAD designer, or you're a project manager, or you're a construction administrator. You are whatever you're needed to be as long as you're qualified for the assignment. You may wear multiple hats. Small firm employees have to wear multiple hats. That's the natural function and operation of a small firm. So you have to define these positions clearly so they understand what's expected of them. Some of them will clearly know. Some of them will have the experience to automatically understand, but you can't assume that they know. You want to develop the best possible resource for them to understand and perform the expectation that you have for your firm.
Okay, so delineate a very clear expectation and goals that employees can then, and even firm principals can use to guide their behavior. Am I understanding correctly?
Well, I wouldn't just use the word expectation. I would say to define for them the roles and responsibilities of their position, the things that they do, the activities that are most likely to be engaged in on a regular basis.
Yes.
Periodically and routinely. In bigger firms, it's more segmented. It's more horizontally set. It could be any number of things. Project managers do project manager work. Project architects do project architect work. Project designers do project design work. Well, in small firms, that's not the case. The project designer could be the project architect and the project manager. So what are the roles of these 3 kinds of titles? This isn't something that you're going to put on a business card. I'm a project manager. No, not if you wear 3 hats, you're not. It's just one thing that you can do, but the question is, what are the goals for doing what you do? What does it include? What does it entail? What's needed from you in terms of functioning as effectively as you possibly can in each role? That becomes a dialogue between you and these individuals. So in a collaborative way, you develop a position description for these roles that anybody in the firm might assume, including you, the owner. You might have to be the project manager on a number of projects or a project designer on a number of projects, and likely are.
Let's talk about remuneration, because you mentioned that part of this process of being able to motivate, keep, have accountability, a firm culture of accountability, is to be able to reward and provide rewards. And I don't know if it's monetary or what other ways it can be done, but tell me your insights about how to retain good talent through rewarding them for their performance.
Okay, well, for me, it's about human nature. Every one of us, myself included, certainly always will ask this question, what's in it for me? When I'm asked to do something that I'm not accustomed to doing or is different, or there's a change that's expecting me to do something that I'm not accustomed to doing, that I need to learn to do, to question, the question that I would ask out loud or think to myself is, what's in it for me if I do this? That's a natural response. So in order to overcome that inertia that's created by that question, you have to be able to think about the answer to that question before you begin one of these processes. It's important that you recognize that you come up with a game plan for creating an environment in which that will be fully answered. For some people, money is the answer. You know, what's in it for me? More money. Okay, great. For some people, more money means nothing. For some people, it means more responsibility. I want greater responsibility in my work. Great. That's another way to do it. What's another way? Well, I want a title. Okay, great. We'll find a title that works for you, whatever it happens to be. So in a small firm, it's really easy because you can just ask Mary and Jack and Bill and Fred and Diane exactly what their needs are in that area. What stimulates you? What gets your hot button pushed? What are you striving for? What do you want to be known for? What do you want to accomplish? Those are the questions that bosses don't routinely ask their employees, but that's a part of an employee review process. Part of the goal-setting process is to start with those things. Sure, the firm has the requirements of what they want for this person, the goals that they want that person to achieve, but we ought to ask that person, what do you want to personally achieve in your day-to-day activities throughout the course of the next 12 months? So it's about understanding each of them and what motivates them. Now, when you get to a bigger firm, understand that I've worked for the largest firm in the world for 11 and a half years, and I was the director of operations for half of those years, and you can't possibly do that with every single individual. So you have to define a process that systematizes, that addresses those questions in general. Then as you have those conversations, because it's going to be spread out over a group of project managers who are going to conduct these reviews, they ask the questions. So you spread the responsibility for leading these reviews, and you spread it out to a group of people, and you begin to get the feedback that you want to help build the system.
Excellent. Got it. Well, we've covered a lot in this segment, Steve, about employee retention, about some of the deficiencies or oversights or however we tend to look at it in financial management and small firms. One thing that you didn't mention is it's your feeling, and I know a lot in the industry feel like sometimes salaries are depressed or there would be an opportunity for better recompense or compensation in the industry. So in the following episode, will you reveal some of the secrets of what firms can do to find some of their hidden dollars and manage their money better?
Yes, but they're not secrets.
Okay.
It's all out there for everybody to learn.
All right. Well, next week we're going to dive in right into that. So, Steve, it's been great having you on the show today, and I personally feel like I've learned a ton from you.
Well, thank you for the opportunity. It's been really great.
Excellent. Thank you, Steve.
Okay.
And that's a wrap. Thanks for riding along on another show about the business of architecture. I want to know your opinion about today's episode. Visit businessofarchitecture.com/podcast or send me an email at show@businessofarchitecture.com with your feedback about today's show. And remember, visit businessofarchitecture.com/free to grab your free membership pass to Business of Architecture Insider, where you'll have first access to free resources to help you run a great business. See you next week. The views expressed on this show by my guests do not represent those of the host, and I make no representation, promise, guarantee, pledge, warranty, contract, bond, or commitment, except to help you run a great business. But music credit to Ben Folds 5, Do It Anyway.